Hello everyone and welcome to my channel where we discuss the day-to-day topics that are taught in medical colleges in a much more simpler and easily digestible pattern. Today, I'm going to be starting a series on the congenital anomalies of the kidney, starting with my first topic, the duplication of the ureter. I'm going to start the topic by discussing the headers under which the topic is going to be discussed. Number 1, definition and incidence. Number 2, pathophysiology. Number 3, types, clinical features, diagnosis and management. So, what are we waiting for? Let's get started. Duplication of the ureter. Why is it so important? It is so important because it is the most common congenital anomaly of the upper urinary tract is the duplication of the ureter. What is the incidence of the duplication of the ureter? The incidence is 1%. So let us start with our first topic, that is definition. What is the definition? The definition is duplication of ureter or duplex urinary system is when two ureter drains the same kidney. Let us look at this picture below. One ureter here, one ureter here. Usually there is supposed to be one ureter for one kidney. When two ureters drain the same kidney, it is known as the duplication of the ureter or the duplex urinary system. So, what is the embryology behind this? Normally what happens is that one ureteric bud arises, it goes to the kidney and it results in the formation of one ureter. In duplication of the ureter, there can be two types of anomalies. Number one ureteric bud arises, it splits into two, resulting into formation of two renal pelvises. Two ureteric bud arises and forms two ureters. It results in the formation of two separate ureters draining two parts of the kidney. Let's talk about the incidence. The incidence is 1%. It is an autosomal dominant condition, more commonly found in females. Then let's come to the types. It is of two types. One is incomplete duplication and the second one is complete duplication. Before this, let us look at these two pictures. One picture shows a single ureter. The next picture shows two different ureters. Which type do we call incomplete? The one that has two bifurcations near the kidney. Finally, it fuses to form one ureter. That is known as the incomplete type of duplication of the ureter. And what is the complete type of the duplication of the ureter? When two separate ureters arise from the same kidney and they end up separately as well, it is known as complete duplication of the ureter. So what is complete duplication of the ureter? Let me make it clear. When two ureters arise from the same kidney and they end up in different locations, one ending in the bladder and one ending in a site away from the bladder, this is known as complete duplication of the ureter. We have two types, incomplete duplication and complete duplication of the ureter. Incomplete duplication is known as bifid ureter and complete duplication is complete duplication of the ureter. Normal name, complete duplication of the ureter. What is the Weigert-Meyer rule? I'll come to this a little bit later. Let us look at the incomplete duplication of the bifid ureter. You can see in one situation, the bifurcation is a little proximal and in one situation, the bifurcation is a little distal. But we cannot just use scientific terms like proximal and distal. We have to find a specific location before which or after which we can call the bifurcation proximal or distal. This region is known as the PUJ or the pelvi-uretric junction. You say this, the PUJ is over here. Based on that, we have two different types of bifid ureter. If the bifurcation is before the PUJ, it is treated as a single ureter. No abnormality. Treated as a single ureter with no abnormality. And if the bifurcation is after PUJ, that is after the pelvi-uretric junction, it is treated as a true bifid ureter. It is treated as a true bifid ureter. Now, we come to the Weigert-Meyer rule. Let us read this theory that is present before us. Ureteral drainage pattern is normally governed by the Meyer-Weigert rule, predicting that the ureter of the upper part usually drains inferomedially into an ectopic location, which commonly leads to obstruction. The lower ureter part usually drains superolaterally to its normal insertion in the trigone. What is this? So, I have written a simple explanation over here. Let us presume that there are two separate ureters draining two separate parts of the kidney. One ureter drains the upper pole of the kidney or the superior lobe of the kidney, and one ureter drains the inferior pole or the inferior lobe of the kidney. So, let us draw a diagram for what I am saying. One kidney before you, two ureters. So, one ureter drains the upper part of the kidney and one ureter drains the remainder lower part of the kidney. So, we have ureter number 1 and we have ureter number 2. The Weigert-Meyer rule states what will happen to these ureter 2. What happens is that the superior one is treated a little unfairly. It states that the ureter that originates from the superior pole of the kidney will drain in an ectopic location away from the bladder. See, ureter of the upper part usually drains inferomedially into an ectopic location, which commonly leads to obstruction. Let us not think about this part. Now, usually drains inferomedially into an ectopic location. So, the ureter that is superiorly located will come down and drain. Say this is the bladder. So, the ureter will come and not drain into the bladder. It will drain inferomedially into a location away from the bladder. Okay, and so what happens to the lower ureter? What happens to the lower ureter is that the lower ureter will come down and it will drain into the normal location in the bladder trigone. So, the lower ureter is normally situated in the bladder trigone. It will normally end in the bladder trigone. But the superior ureter will drain in a location away from the bladder trigone. This is the Weigert-Meyer rule. So, we have a picture of complete duplication of the ureter over here. You see, we have two ureters. One is superiorly located and one is inferiorly located. Now let us trace them down. See, the ureter that is inferiorly located normally ends up in the bladder trigone. It normally ends up in the region of the bladder trigone. But the ureter that is superiorly located, that is this one, let us trace this ureter. The ureter that is superiorly located, it does not end up normally in the bladder. It ends up in an ectopic site away from the bladder. This is what Weigert-Meyer rule is about. Okay, what is the second part of the Weigert-Meyer rule? Ureter of the upper part commonly leads to obstruction. Ureter of the lower part usually drains in the trigone. It does not say the remainder of the portion. The ureter of the lower part usually leads to VUR. So, ureter of the upper part commonly leads to obstruction. Ureter of the lower part leads to VUR, that is vesicoureteric reflux. So, this is the two part of the Weigert-Meyer rule. So, let us talk about complete duplication of the ureter. See, that upper pole ureter has obstruction. Lower pole ureter has vesicoureteric reflux. Okay. So, what are the conditions that leads to the obstruction of the upper pole ureter, that is the superior pole ureter? The upper pole ureter has obstruction because of ureterocene, and the lower pole ureter has vesicoureteric VUR because of short intravesical length. Okay, we will discuss about these topics later, because I will be making a video on VUR where I'll be dealing with every single condition, like why is a short intravesical length causes a VUR and other such conditions. So I'm not going to be going into details in this video. So let us find out the next topic. most common site of the ectopic ureteric orifice. See, you have your urethra, okay? In the urethra, you have urethral sphincters. You have urinary sphincters. One is internal urinary sphincter, one is external urinary sphincter. What are the function of these urinary sphincters? Normally, above this, we have the bladder. So, normally, the bladder is a structure that is usually filled with urine. So, if these sphincters did not exist, there will be leakage of urine from the bladder. So, the function of the sphincter is to hold the urine inside the bladder until the bladder becomes sufficiently filled. Say there is an opening in this region. The ureter comes and opens in this region. Will it lead to incontinence? No, because despite the fact that the ureter has bypassed the internal urinary sphincter, there is still the external urinary sphincter. It will not allow the urine to dribble. So, if this is the location of the ectopic ureter, there will be no dribbling or no incontinence of urine. The next ectopic site of opening is over here. Will it lead to incontinence? Yes. Why will it lead to incontinence? Because it is below the level of both the internal as well as the external urinary sphincters. So what happens is that the ureter drains in this region and the urine directly goes out without any sphincter to prevent the drainage of the urine. So if the ectopic site is in this region, there will be no incontinence and no dribbling of urine. But if the ectopic site is in this region, there will be incontinence and dribbling of urine. So we have openings, but they differ in male and female. Usually in males, orifice is in prostatic urethra proximal to external urinary sphincter. Females, orifice of upper pole is in anterior urethra and distal to the external urinary sphincter. Why have I talked so much about this point? This point is important because this will help us to understand the clinical problems that the patient will present with. So, if the patient has opening here, the patient will not complain of incontinence. The patient will have only one complaint, that is the patient will have a repeated UTI. Why? It is because the opening is very close to the outside. So it is very easy for infection to travel up and cause urinary tract infection. Okay? But if the opening is in this region, the patient will not present to you with UTI. Patient will give you history is that I have dribbling, but my normal voiding pattern is maintained. What does that mean? That means is that the patient will give history that I have constant dribbling of urine or constant incontinence. But along with that, I also feel the urge for urination. And when I go to urinate, the urination that I do is normal. So, what will be the history? The history will be incontinence associated with normal voiding pattern. But if the opening is over here, there will be no history of incontinence, there will be no problem in voiding patterns. The patient will present to you with UTI. Okay? Our next topic is investigations. So, I have divided the investigations into two parts. For complete duplication of ureter, DOU, and for incomplete DOU or duplication of ureter. Let us first look into the investigations for complete duplication of the ureter. Sorry, upper pole ureter has obstruction due to uretrocele. So, if we do an IVP, that is intravenous pyelogram, we will get an adder head or cobra head appearance. This is very common for uretrocele and I will deal with this appearance in the topic of uretrocele. An investigation of choice for VUR is MCU, that is micturating cystourethrogram. I will again deal with this topic when I am talking about VUR. For right now, just know that the superior pole has obstruction. The diagnosis of choice for uretrocele is adder head or cobra overhead appearance, and the diagnosis of choice for VUVAD is MC. Investigation for incomplete DOU, remember, it is yo-yo reflex. If you do an RGP, that is a retrograde pylogram, in which dye is injected from a distal to proximal manner, and then you see the renal pelvis in a X-ray plate, the renal pelvis looks like this. See, this is known as yo-yo reflex. This is known as yo-yo reflex. It is two heads. See, it is two heads. One head, two head. And then it joins and forms a complete single ureter. This is known as the yo-yo reflux. So let us just study the theory that is available for yo-yo reflux. Reflux of contrast in both limbs of the ureter on retrograde pylogram in incomplete DOU is known as yo-yo reflux. There is also a very important and very interesting sign in complete duplication of the ureter. It is known as the drooping lily sign. So what is the drooping lily sign? What do you mean by a drooping lily? It means that a lily or a flower which is wilted. What should be the appearance of such a flower? The appearance of such a flower should be like this. This is the same thing that is found in the drooping lily sign. Let us look at these two pictures. Like the one I have drawn here, see, you can also find changes over here. See, the changes just like that of a drooping lily. Just like that of a drooping lily. This is known as the drooping lily sign. So what is the pathogenesis behind the drooping lily sign? You have your kidney, beautiful, beautiful kidney, which has an upper pole draining system and a lower pole draining system. There will also be an ureteroscene that will cause obstruction. And the lower, it will go into the urinary bladder and it will drain superolaterally into the urinary bladder. So this is my urinary bladder. Okay, it is a box. Yes, my urinary bladder is a box. Okay, so what happens is that if there is an obstruction, urine will not be able to flow out. So urine becomes stagnant first in the ureter, then the urine becomes stagnant in the pelvic ileal system. Then urine becomes stagnant in the kidney parenchyma itself, leading to the formation of hydronephrosis. But will the hydronephrosis affect the entire kidney? No, the hydronephrosis will only affect that part of the kidney that is being drained by the superior pole ureter. That is the superior part of the kidney. So, obstruction by ureteroceal in the superior pole ureter will lead to reflux of urine, will lead to hydronephrosis. So the superior pole has become hydronephrotic, the superior pole has become heavy, and the superior pole is now drooping down on the sheer pressure of its weight. Because it has become filled with urine, filled with water. So it is drooping down on the sheer pressure based on its sheer weight. So what will happen? See, hydronephrotic superior pole of the kidney, normally it was erect. What will happen now is the superior pole will start to droop down, and based on a sheer weight, the superior pole will start to droop down. Had the entire kidney become hydronephrotic, then this would not have happened. But since the superior pole alone has become hydronephrotic, the superior pole becomes heavy and it starts to droop down. So what happens to the inferior pole? The inferior pole, which was previously in its normal position, now it becomes inferior and lateral in position. And the ureter that was draining the inferior pole, first it was initially erect. See, it was initially erect. But now what will happen is that the ureter, there will be a stress on the ureter because the normal position was like this. Now it has become like this. And the pelvic ileal system, which was normally like this, it will now become like this. See? Now, if you do an IVP, what happens? The lower bowel ureter is the only one that is going to be stained with the IVP. Why? Because this part of the kidney has become non-functional due to hydronephrosis. So only the lower bowel of the kidney will drain. And it looks like a drooping lily. I have nothing else to say. It looks like a drooping lily. That is why the name of the sign is drooping lily sign. Because superior pole ureter always has an ureteroseal attached to it in the ectopic site where it drains. Once the ureteroseal becomes blocked, the superior pole undergoes hydronephrosis. After the superior pole undergoes hydronephrosis, the superior pole droops down on the basis of a shear weight and due to gravity. As a result of which, what happens is that the inferior pole moves outwards and naturally, resulting in the pulling of the normal pelvic ischial system, lower pole pelvic ischial system. This is the drooping lily sign. So let us come to the last point, that is management. For the management, you follow this chart. Okay, when you are going to write management for your exams, you follow this chart. So management, you have complete DOU, duplication of ureter, and incomplete DOU. For complete DOU, you have upper pole problems and lower pole problems. And for upper pole problems, you have upper pole ureter with hydronephrosis, upper pole ureter without hydronephrosis. So let us start from the simplest one. Okay, the incomplete DOU. So for the incomplete DOU, you need not do anything because the incomplete DOU usually does not cause any problem. So for incomplete DOU, no treatment. Or if some problem does arise, like UTI, some problems do arise, just do symptomatic management. Now we have the lower pole ureter. So let us first study the lower pole ureter. The lower pole ureter usually will present with what kind of problem? The lower pole ureter presents with VUR. For the lower pole ureter, do a UVP, that is uretrovesicoplasty. What it means is that just a junction between the ureter and the bladder such that there is no VUR. Okay, now let us come to upper pole ureter. For the upper pole ureter, let us first treat without hydronephrosis. Okay, so if there is no hydronephrosis, you need not do anything. Just remove, excise the ectopic insertion of the ureter and implant it in the normal bladder. This is upper pole without hydronephrosis. But if there is upper pole with hydronephrosis, like we discussed a little bit back with the drooping lily sign, if there is hydronephrosis, you cannot save the kidney. So do a nephrectomy and excise out the entire hydronephrotic portion. Along with that, also do a UVP, that is uretrovesicoplasty. Why? To strengthen the uretrovesical junction such that there is no VUR. Prevent the complication of the lower pole ureter in the same surgery such that there is no VUR. So this completes our discussion on duplication of the ureter. I hope you like this video. If you like this video, just give a thumbs up below. And if you are interested in the notes that comes with this video, just comment down in the comment section below. I'll be very happy to provide the notes if you guys want that. So thanking you for watching with this video. I hope you have a very nice day. Bye. Good night.